Rove Live is classified M and is recommended for viewing by mature audiences. It may contain some coarse language and adult themes.
Hey, Sarah Marie, tough luck about the voting the other night.
What do you mean?
Well, I mean, like, everyone loved you. You were the princess of the nation, and then they just kicked you out.
I made it to the end. I only left the day one day.
Oh, yeah, but it was so close. Like, you know, one or two more votes, and you almost could have won it.
It doesn't bother me, babe. I'm happy to be out, honestly.
Doesn't bother you? 250 grand, and now it goes to Ben.
Robot dancing's back. 8:30, is that right?
8:30? Are you sure this isn't Charmed? Sure it's not Charmed?
The only witchcraft you will see tonight is comedy witchcraft. Yes, thank you very much. Hey, Big Brother's finished. Are we all okay? It's all over. People are probably feeling a few withdrawal symptoms. I've got a really good suggestion. Why don't you freeze yourself and then get defrosted for Big Brother 2? No, yeah, sounds odd. Some are going, don't know what you're talking about. Others are excited and going, woo! That's good to know, because you see, what's happened is an announcement has been made that they are planning on opening some cryogenic body banks here in Australia, so you can freeze yourself and then be brought back to life years in advance. That's fantastic. I love it. It's a great idea. Although I think the idea of a bank with cold, hard corpses in it is really weird. Although I guess it's not that much different to what we have at the moment, so, you know, it's the same old thing. Probably less of a wait, actually. Although I will say this, if they do open body banks in the country, make sure you get there before closing time, because it's really hard to put a frozen person in the after-hours slot. I'm trying to just... How good was that mine? He's really got a dead person there. It's fantastic. But I hope that if they do start freezing people, that the defrosting process, that they'll put a lot of thought into it. Somehow I can't help but think that all they're going to do is just bang people against the sink like an ice cube tray. Just put them under the hot tap. You're damn frozen humans! That's all they'll be able to do. Or, you know, that they won't be able to do it promptly, and people, when they are defrosted, their future family will come up to embrace them and they'll still be a little bit cold, and the family will come up and give them a big kiss and then get stuck. Yeah! I hate that. I don't even know why people would want to be frozen in the first place, because just imagine 100 years down the track, when you get defrosted, people are just going to bug you with questions about the past. You'll have all these scientists coming up to you going, we've been going over all these archaeological plans from 2001, and we've got this one question that's just bugging us. What's with all the bunny ears? You see what I mean? You see what I mean? Are you ready for a huge show this evening? So big, it needs 2 hours to fill it. Good Lord. On the show tonight, Mariah Carey, Mandy Moore, Rachel Griffiths, Justin Torkelson from The Bold and the Beautiful, plus all the Big Brother kids here tonight. Don't go anywhere, you will regret it. The nation was riveted last night for the final episode of Big Brother. Ben went home the victor, but one person who has also been there from day one that most people seem to be forgetting about is almost the 15th House member. She joins us tonight, the hostess with the mostest, Gretel Killeen. Hello.
Nobody's forgetting about me. Thank you. Yeah.
Were you out partying with the rest of them last night?
Yes. None of us can talk.
How buggered are you?
Yeah, pretty tired is the word we use, but yes, I'm pretty tired.
What did you do? What did you all get up to?
Well, this weekend we did show after show. So two nights we did 4 hours of live television with no idea of who was coming out. Sarah Marie suddenly came in at the end and was to be evicted on the Sunday night. So we're winging and ad-libbing the entire show. making it look like it's completely normal. Emotional, because, you know, I love everybody like everyone else does in the house, and we'd cut to buggy rides and there's makeup going, Petal, stop crying, stop crying. You look so ugly. Oh, yeah, all right. Anyway, so we did all of that, and then last night was the big party.
Now, you deserved it, I tell you what. Do you know what you sound? You sound like the little...
Don't say anything mean or I'll
no,
cry.
No, the little guy from The Simpsons, you know, the, oh, get your taco out of the deep fryer. I was talking to Blair before the show, and he's the same, but I think his voice is just like that normally.
Blair's copying me because he thinks it's cool.
Was it as exciting for you when everyone was getting evicted? Because people forget that you weren't in the house every week with them. You were watching from the outside, and when they came out, you were as excited as the rest of us. How was it every week?
Well, terrifying to do a live show in front of all those people. And then, of course, to know, like last night we had 3.2 million people watching the show.
That's incredible.
Which is, that's all my friends. I don't know about you guys. And how was it? It was difficult because on the one hand, and this is what a lot of people in the public were like, oh, I'm voting so-and-so out because I really want them out here so I can say hello to them. Or I want to meet Blair. I think it'd be good to vote him out. I think, oh, that's not really the way it works, but okay. So I'd be sad on the one hand that someone is leaving, excited at the thought that I would be meeting them. And then knowing that two others were happy to still be staying. I mean, there were just so many emotions going on. Mm. And of course, the emotions have run wild this week because 200 of us have been transplanted to the Gold Coast for 3, 4, 5 months and we've made a little family. Oh. And now we're all sad and heartbroken.
Oh, I can imagine. Now, when you first came on the show, before, because you came on here just before Big Brother started, did you have any idea it was going to be that huge? Especially like when you signed onto it.
Well, no, and I should have negotiated a much better...
Ah, royalty fees, damn it!
Someone's a fool, but never mind. Look, we knew it had been huge in England, but I didn't, you know, the English are not us. And when they were saying it had been grabbed by society there and people were racing home to watch it, I thought, well, okay, that's England, doesn't necessarily mean anything about the way we're going to respond to it. And I remember when I went in to do an audition thing and they said, oh, now, Greta, we want you to imagine that you're saying this in front of 1,000 people. And the 1,000 people was the cameraman and a guy holding the lighting adjuster and someone else. And then I'd say something and they'd go, yay, yay. And I thought, bloody heavens, can we say that in this time?
Bloody hell, yeah.
Bloody heavens, I said, to soften it up.
Yeah, because it's the hell part that's the problem, not the bloody part. No, that's fine.
I told you I hadn't slept. Anyway, so I had no idea. But I have to tell you that for those of us who have been working on the show, I don't think yet there really is a comprehension of how big it has been because we've been in this parallel universe. We've been in there, you know, people doing 36-hour shifts and sleeping on the floor and all that sort of business to get this show. The turnaround has just been enormous. So I think many of us are going to take a little bit of time out to just reminisce.
Well, I tell you what, you bloody deserve it. But one thing I would like to do here...
Thanks, mate.
Bloody hell. Of course, now you always ask the housemates the famous 11 Big Brother questions.
Oh, here we go.
So now I would like to ask you my own special version of the 11 Big Brother questions. Okay, you ready? Question one, what did you miss most while you were being the most famous woman on television?
Nothing. Question two.
Drinking, but you made up for it last night, so it's okay.
That's true, I tried to be
Who was your favourite housemate?
I'm not going to answer that.
You loved Blair and Gordon. You loved them. You wanted to pash them. You so wanted to pash them. I'm sorry, you did.
I'm sorry, and you're getting that information from where?
From watching the show.
Oh, yeah, I really wanted to pash Gordon and Blair. And that's how Blair lost his voice too.
Yeah. Who was your least favourite housemate?
I'm not going to answer that.
Why not?
I don't have a least
It was Anita,
favorite.
Wasn't it? You didn't like
it
Anita.
Was not
it was Shana.
It
wasn't.
No. It's
Ebony?
Becoming you.
Was it the chook? who was the most annoying to interview afterwards?
Yeah, that'd be you.
That's me again. Cool. We're going well here so far. Who's the person you could most fall in love with?
Oh, I can hear people out there going, I'm going through my mind, yep. All the boys.
All the boys?
And in another life, all the girls as well.
Oh, yeah.
Again.
Who was the funniest?
Well, I understand Ben was the funniest.
But for you?
I loved watching Sarah Marie. Yeah. I just found her hilarious.
Who was the dullest?
This is like saying, which of your children do you like most and which would you like to sacrifice?
Yeah, pretty much. Who was the dullest?
Look, I'm sorry to give you the dullest 2 hour, 2 minutes of television. I can't answer that.
No? Okay, what about this one? Who was your... who was the least favourite friend or relative of each of the housemates?
Oh, yes! Let's answer that one.
No? Okay.
Because they come up each week and partied with us, you know that.
Yep. Did you sleep with any of the crew? I'll change that.
No, I didn't sleep with any of the crew. And that's the thing I miss about being famous.
Would you host Series 2?
Oh, that's what Channel 10 are talking about. That's what everybody's asking. Nobody, we haven't finished Series 1 as far as I'm concerned. So, look, what a great experience. I'd be an idiot to say no.
Oh, it wouldn't be the same without you, I can tell you that. Will you please thank Gretel Colleen?
Thank you.
Now, Gretel, help me out for a second here, because... of course, the house has been vacated last night, of course, with Ben being the last one to go. I love the way at the last bit he just moved that couch. They just went, you're the last person left in the house, just went, I'll move the couch ever so slightly. DreamWorld, of course, which is the home of Big Brother, will be opening the house to the general public on February 23. But until then, the first people, the first humans to be put into the house are happening tonight with our own Peter Hellyer, Corinne Grant, and our bunch of live listers. We'll cross to them now. But before we do, would you do the cross for us? You know, do that quiet as a mouse thing that you do.
All right. You know what time it is? We're going to cross to the house. You know what that means? Quiet as a mouse.
And then what do you say?
Oh, I say nothing. Oh, there they are.
Hello.
Oh,
hello.
Look at them. Hi. Oh, it's good to be confirmed.
How's it going?
Oh, very exciting.
Very exciting, Grove. We have an update. I actually had some Indian for dinner, and as a result, I had to use the Big Brother toilet, and I think they're not going to get the bond back.
Very classy stuff, Pete. Very classy stuff. Now, what have you got planned for us tonight?
Okay, we've got four people off the live list, as everybody would know, and four celebrities with them. So let's bring them through the doors now and meet them, okay?
Okay.
Come on in, guys!
Come on in!
Hey! Woo! Here they come! Oh, aren't they gorgeous?
Marissa Bendy.
And Joey.
And Joey, we met
Joey. Oh, this is Joey from last week. G'day, Joey. Peter Rosethorn. It's Grant Kenny! It's Grant Kenny!
He's lying there!
First game, and I guess we'll see you then.
Sounds pretty exciting. Pete and Corinne, thank you very much. We'll be crossing back to the house later on when we return here on Rove Live, Mariah Carey. Welcome back. Haha, I made a stuff up. On purpose. The Big Brother house is open to the public on July 23rd. July 23rd. You don't have to wait till February, so that's okay. Crisis is over. People just going, oh! So it's all right. Okay, we don't have to panic. And also, let me announce that tonight on the Big Brother website, www.bigbrother.com.au, some of the items from the Big Brother house are going to be up for auction, including Sarah Marie's bed, the diary room chair, Blair's sheets, the shower caddy. Yay! That kind of stuff. So bidding will close at 10 o'clock tonight and we'll find out who gets what. So log on to bigbrother.com.au and find out all the details there. It is now time to welcome our next guest for this evening. She is the biggest female recording artist in the world. She has sold over 150 million albums and had more number ones than any other female on the planet. And her new single, Lover Boy, looks set to follow suit. She joins us now all the way from New York City. Please welcome Mariah Carey.
Hi, Rose.
How are you?
Hi, Australia. I'm good. How are you?
I am feeling so very good looking across and seeing your lovely face.
Well, likewise.
You're looking great. Are you feeling great?
I feel all right.
Oh, good.
I've been up for like 20-something hours.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, that's all right. Now, you have been up for 20-something hours because you were telling me that you've just finished wrapping a film as of this morning. Is that correct?
Yes, 3 a.m. And then I got home. I guess I got in bed about 6 a.m. And I'm fine, but the rest of the people with me are, like, ready to collapse. They're seeing double of everything.
Now, the film you just wrapped was Wise Guys, and you were giving me a bit of your wise guy
wise
accent.
Wise girls, actually.
A wise girls accent.
Well, it was... Yes. Well, my character is a girl named Rachel, but if I go into that accent, I may not be able to lose her, and I'm a little bit afraid of that. You really want me to do it?
Yes, I would love to.
Yeah.
Okay. Her name is Rachel. She's freaking in Staten Island. You know, they're doing some things over there at the freaking Santolino's, Il Santolino's restaurant. Whatever. We don't want to talk about it. Everybody's driving. She's going to want a freaking nut house after this whole thing. You know, everybody's a little bit crazy.
I want a freaking
but
pizza,
right,
a coffee, and a hot dog.
Oh, yeah. Shells with sauce, marinade, whatever you want. She got it. It's freaking Rachel. So they were calling her the Rach.
Can you do an Australian accent at all?
Absolutely not. I would need lessons for that.
I would definitely need. You just talk.
Would you help me with that?
Yes, just simply talk through your nose and try not to open your mouth as best you can. And it's just a bit of give me a pizza and put that feather in my hair.
I wouldn't even attempt it with somebody as astute as you are.
Well, thank you very much.
At that accent. I can talk to you like this all day if you want me to. That's a whole nother character.
Oh, please.
I don't need to get into her either.
See, now I'm fantasizing. It's getting all a bit creepy. Now, I must congratulate you because you have just signed a deal with Virgin Records, which I have heard is somewhere around the $23 million mark, and they haven't even heard a single note from this album.
You want me to talk to you about numbers? You want me to tell you reality?
Give me a bit of both.
No, I don't. I know my ABCs, but I really don't know my 1-2-3s at all. I mean, I'm not very good with numbers. Let's just put it this way. Thank God that I now have an accountant who's going to take care of me because I was almost the behind the music poster child, but that's okay. Because Virgin Records is great. We're starting over, and this new project is Glitter, which is my new album and also the title of the movie, which is not the one where I'm playing the psychotic waitress that is also doing some bad stuff over there in Staten Island, but it's a movie that's, it's not a musical, but it's integrating music with film, and it's something I wanted to do for like 3.5 years. It's set in 1982, and I'm really excited about it.
We'll get to the movie in a minute because obviously you are best known for being, as I said, the number one female artist in the entire human world. Now, you've probably told this story a million times, but how did you get started?
Well, my mother is a singer. My mother sang with New York City Opera before I was born, and she's a Midwestern Irish American who's also kind of like an opera diva, a very artistic, kind of like, you know, drama queen. That's why diva to me, now that everybody talks about divas, my mother is like queen of all divas. She'd be like, hi, I'm here. Like, you know, the world stops.
Do you mind if people call you a diva?
No, because to me, I've been hearing diva all my life. This is not like a new term. Everybody says to me, what do you think of this new diva craze? I'm like, huh? I've been hearing this since I was freaking 4 years old. Like, what's the newness?
You said freaking.
You know? Freaking four years old. I can't be Rachel.
Cleanse the Rachel. Now, when you were a kid, was this something you always knew you wanted to do?
Yes. I always, basically what I've been saying and what I really honestly mean is that when I was little, singing and creating melodies and stuff saved my life in terms of there was a lot of dysfunction and stuff like that in my life, which we don't need to go into because who cares? I'm happy and blessed and grateful for everything I have, but music was my salvation. Also being different characters and making up characters and doing voices and stuff like that that most people don't understand when they suddenly meet me and I'm like being four different characters. But what was great, about doing Wise Girls with Mira Sorvino and Melora Walters was that I got to actually bring the character of Rachel to life and live vicariously through her, because as me, you know, the regular Mariah, I'm always like, oh, I'm sorry, is this okay? Like, always explaining myself, but Rachel's like, whatever, you're an idiot, get out of here. They're looking at me through the door. Okay, I guess that means that my hair is in my face. All right.
Oh, no, don't mind the hair. Forget about it. You're looking great. What do they know?
Well, when someone looks at you through the window, what are you going to do? Don't say freaking again, she just said.
Who's mouthing again. Off at
All
you?
All right. No. I have to, like, be calm and normal, because people don't understand that I have a personality, so... All right.
Just remember, you are Mariah Carey, and no one tells you what to do. If you want to, you just go give them a bit of this. Give them a bit of your backhand. And go, hey, I'm trying to talk
no,
here.
They're trying to protect me. Okay, I'm going to sit here and be normal. So I started singing when I was 4 years old.
Now, Mariah, just remember, this is you and me talking. I want the real you. I don't want Miss Showbiz Diva Mariah Carey. I want the real you that I've known, that I've grown to love.
You're having it. The problem is you're having the real me right now, but nobody wants me to really kind of go there, because at this moment, it's a bit much.
We're having fun. I say stuff 'em.
We are. Like, if we were at a pub in Australia, this would be fine. But I think all the powers that be want me to form a line and focus and just discuss things as a normal person.
So are you going to be coming to Australia? And if so, do you want to go out drinking, you and me, into a pub?
I mean, I hope I'm coming to Australia, but also I can't really drink beer. It doesn't work for me.
What do you like to drink?
I don't know. Wine? I really can't have, like, the hard liquor. It doesn't work for me.
So no tequila shots?
Oh, no. No. Tequila, I don't work with tequila. I cannot really drink hard liquor at all, basically. I'm okay with some wine and champagne and an occasional sea breeze. Do you guys have sea breezes down there?
No, I'm not quite sure with it. Is that like a cocktail cooler thing?
It's kind of tacky for me to drink one, actually. But it's, I think it's cranberry juice, grapefruit juice, and vodka.
Oh, sounds good.
I can tolerate... It's pretty good, but I do not condone drinking.
Oh, neither do I. I don't condone it.
This is not a commercial. But you do it.
Oh, yeah, it's great. You'll be doing it when you get here, make no doubt about it.
Oh, dear. But let me ask you this, because I went swimming with dolphins in Perth. Do they have dolphins there?
Oh, yes. I grew up in Perth, actually. Is that at Monkey Mia?
I think it is. Wait, you grew up there near where the dolphins are?
Yes, I do. I've actually been there and I've touched dolphins myself.
It's not the best.
Have you ever touched the tongue of a dolphin? It's surprisingly so.
I have. Yes, I have. But this can't get into a weird, freaky area or my manager's going to be at the door.
I can see the headlines now. Mariah Carey touches dolphins.
Tongue. We don't need it.
No, that's fine. Well, I tell you what, you and I, when you come to Australia, we'll get drunk and go out and touch dolphins. Sounds good to me.
But I never have any time. I can't get drunk. We can have a few drinks, but definitely the dolphin thing, okay?
Definitely.
All right.
Well,
thank you for tolerating this, my end of the night craziness. This is kind of my way of entertaining myself. I hope the world... or at least Australia understands.
We do. We have a very good sense of humour. And believe me, you have won a lot of fans and a lot of hearts tonight. Thank you very much for joining us. Mariah Carey.
Thank you, Ro. I'll see you when I come down there.
Thank you. I didn't know what she was talking about. They're like a Bacardi Breezer kind of thing. Is that it? Oh, I don't know. We're going drinking, and if you're going to give me crap, you can't come. That was Mariah Carey, of course, and her new single, Loverboy, is available in stores, and the album Glitter is released on August 20. When we return on Rove Live, the winner of Big Brother, Ben. Welcome back to Rove Live. huge show, so much still to come. The entire cast of Big Brother, including winner Ben, who's coming up in a minute, as well as Mandy Moore, so much more coming up. Oh, I said more too many times, I'm now getting confused. Now, of course, speaking of big, all things Big Brother, a lot of rumours going around about Series 2, when it will happen, who will be involved, and it will require, of course, another bunch of human people going inside a house for about 3 months. Who would be interested in doing that, audience? And people at home? Yes, very interesting. So I thought I would go roving with Rove to see who would be interested. Would you ever be willing, Robert, to lock yourself away for 3 months?
No, thank you.
No, man, no.
Because I wouldn't want to make my own bread. It'd be like rock hard.
Yeah, what's with that making?
They need it so much. Oh, so...
Well, of course they need it. Without it, they'd go hungry. Mandy's away.
It'd be a bit of fun. Meet new people, get famous.
Hey, we didn't write that. We didn't script it.
Wow.
This could be the show. What would you do with $250,000?
I'd just spend it.
I'd give a little bit to the other two that were left.
Nah, they're losers. They don't need money. Is there anyone you would like to be locked away with for 3 months?
No, not 79.
You'd want to be locked up with people you hate?
Yeah, so I can get a bit of hard time.
Would there be a bit of the dancing doona happening there, Gilbert?
No. I'm past that date now.
Oh,
I'm going on 76.
Well, yeah. 250 grand, just think of how much Viagra you could buy with that. You would be the idiot of the house.
Yeah, I figure I would.
I'd love to be a prankster.
Ah.
I'd probably be the one that drove everybody nuts and...
Oh, they've got heaps of them in there already. What do you think is the one thing you would miss the most?
Freedom.
Furniture? As in the furniture?
No.
Like, you know, when you get this urge to go and do something and then you wouldn't be able to do it.
Yeah. Like, you know,
yeah.
It's just to... hug that guy when he walks past?
Yeah, I'm sure he'd hug me back too.
Excuse me, sir. This girl, can she just give you a hug?
Hi, darling.
How are you?
Can't do that in the house. What's the one item you would take in with you?
Don't know. Sorry, I'm not going to help. I hate
your other glove?
Take a whole bunch of lens caps.
No, that wouldn't work.
It would. Look, you're telling me that wouldn't work. To the toilet right now, no one even knows.
The painting equipment.
Mm. That's good. And what's this? Would you paint the house? Would you, if you get bored, you could paint yourself?
Murals.
I would put paint on my bum and then you paint the wall like this. Just paint the wall.
Hips, I'd get twice as much done because it's so bigger. So we'd go along like this.
See, mine's like a little paint thing, yours like the roller.
Yeah, exactly right. You do the edges and I do in the middle. I fill in the gaps.
See, and I do the little fine bits. I'll tell you what, one man who knows what it's like to be in amongst it is the winner of Big Brother. It was announced last night. He is the man of the moment and $250,000 richer until the tax man gets his hands on it. Will you please welcome winner of Big Brother Series 1, Ben. Things good with you?
Oh, it's quite a strange sort of feeling, right?
Is it all still a little bit too much to take in?
Yeah, it's still a dream. I can't believe it's happening.
How drunk did you get last night, Sunshine?
Had a big night. I haven't been to bed yet.
And you haven't been to bed?
Nah, but no one else has either. Well, not many of them have. So everyone's looking a bit red-eyed at the moment.
Oh, well, I'll be chatting a bit more about this when you're all here together, but when the Big Brother group get out on the terps, what's it like? I mean, before you answer, we pretty much saw it every night on the show. But why is it different when you're outside?
Well, it's happened once and it was the best night of my life. Had an absolute ball just to be with them all when the cameras aren't there, when we're at the after party. And just to relax and meet their families and friends, it was really good.
Now, with your winnings, there's been a lot of talk around the press today, radio, that kind of thing, that the tax man's getting about half of your winnings. Is that true?
I heard about that. I had a quick look at the paper this morning, but I have absolutely no idea because I've got no idea about taxation, but I'll speak to someone at Channel 10 and see what they reckon I should do.
Would you crack the sands if that was the case? Because you can't say... No, you can't say the winner gets 250 grand until the taxman takes 210 grand. Would you? No, if they turn around and say you only get like 125 grand, would you just go and, I don't know, go on some campaign just to really cause trouble?
Go on a hunger strike because I need it. Obviously, I'd prefer to have all the money so I can do a few things that I want to do with it. But if you can't really fight them, can you?
Well, you can.
You can. Yeah.
Well, okay. Let's get in touch with us.
Yep.
Let us know if they're going to start taxing your ass. Mm. We, as a nation, we will cry foul. Will we?
Yes.
And we'll have some Save Ben's Fund campaign.
That'll be great.
That'd be great.
Yeah.
Now, the one thing you weren't actually asked last night was, what are you going to do with the money?
I've had a bit more of a think about it today. I've spent a bit on my family and friends, and I spoke to one of the big brothers today. I'm planning to do something with a charity, which I can't quite reveal right now. We're going to try to organise something, but we'll, make it public in a week or two.
Okay. Doing good things.
Yeah, helping out people in need.
Spend a bit on yourself too.
Enjoy. I don't know. See what happens.
Oh, you're a nice guy. Oh, the girls are good. You're so sensitive. Now, what was it like when they announced you were the winner and you and Blair embraced? It was a beautiful thing. And what happened then when Blair has to exit the house? You were left for something like half an hour by yourself.
Yeah.
What was going through your head? What were you doing?
Well, I'd geared myself to go first because I thought Blair was an absolute shoo in order to put the farm on him. So it was, I was completely shocked. And it's unbelievable. I just couldn't believe it.
And how about that walk? So what were you thinking about at the time, all of this? Like, what was going through your head?
What was going through my head? It shouldn't be me. I can't believe it, and I'm about to see my family and friends and see all the fans, and there's a lot of noise out there, and I'm ready to have a good night.
Now, do you feel that maybe what helped you get by was the fact that, there's two things. One, that you're a very humorous guy, that was something that seemed to have come across towards the end, but also that in the early stages, you sort of laid low, you weren't like an Andy or someone who was making a name for themselves early on. So do you think you sort of flew under the radar, that kind of thing?
Yeah, I didn't really want to whip anyone on the first episode. But that's Andy and she's great. I was just getting to know everyone for the first few weeks, really. I didn't want to sort of be loud and out there because, I wanted to get to know everyone and didn't want to overstep my mark.
Now, one of the things you're probably also best known for is when Ebony the dog was put in, you were one of the campaigners to get her out. How did you feel when they decided to put the dog in?
It was great when they were going to put the dog in because, we had something new to occupy our minds because you just sit there twiddling your thumbs all the time. It was really good, but she was really, really unhappy and she would have got worse, I reckon. So it was good to get her back to her owner, and I don't know if you saw it, but when she was with her owner, she was a totally different dog. So it was the right thing to do in the end.
Ah, you're a good boy. And he loves animals, girls. That's two now. let's talk about you and Blair, because you became exceptionally close, best mates, love each other. Do you think it's going to last? How close are you?
Blair's one of my best mates. He's unbelievable. I would have lasted about 14 minutes if he wasn't there. It was, great to have him there, and it kept me going, kept me laughing, just kept me enjoying myself, and I really thank him for that.
Now, how do you think you would have gone if he was evicted earlier then?
Probably would have been harder. Like, because, we kept each other going, knocking each other and just bantering and bouncing off each other. So, we had fun together. Thank God.
And now with all of you as a group, because you did get very close, even with Sarah Marie at the end, did you find as it was getting whittled down that you just became closer as a group?
Yeah, because the bond, you're there for that time together and it's getting more intense, and that's a bond you share every week. When someone goes, a part of their personality goes with them, but everyone adopts a part of their personality that's left. So it's quite, it's a strange feeling, it's a strange bond that you develop.
Now, you were one of the people who I used to notice on eviction nights on the Sunday when people were getting kicked out, you were the one who would normally take note of the crowd chanting. And I've asked this of most people now, and especially you, being the winner, what did you expect when you walked out of that house?
At the start, when we were meant to be in the couch out inside, when Big Brother told us to wait there, you could hear the crowd out there. And everyone was saying, you could even hear Big Brother, or people on the stage talking, who do you think's going to win? And people would say, Blair, Blair, Blair. You get the occasional Ben. And then so I thought, I'm definitely gone now. So I was gearing myself for that, but it was, so strange. And I was
so then what's it like, and here you are walking out and you see the fam as well, what is it like every week when you get to that point where the nominations are announced? Look at this, it's just, you couldn't even move. And what is Jota, by the way?
Jota!
Jota!
I used to work with a Korean guy when we were doing a bit of labouring, and he couldn't speak too much English. And he always used to say Jota, which means very good in Korean. That's virtually the only word he said. So knowing me, if I find something flogging, I flog the hell out. If I find something funny, I flog the hell out of it. So yeah, just made something out of that.
Jota.
Yeah, what a stupid word.
Oh, I've got a million dumb catchphrases. You're talking to the preacher of the converted here. Now, what are you going to do now? You're the number one guy in the country, 250 grand, maybe $5 in your pocket, whatever it is, we work it out. What are you going to get up to?
I'm just going to enjoy myself and just see what happens and, yeah, just spend some time with my family and friends when all this is over. Get to meet a few of the fans and just, yeah, just enjoy it while it lasts.
Is there anything you'd like to do, like in the field? A lot of you are coming out and saying you'd like to get into media. Do you have any plans like that?
I love sport. Love sport, love the media. So if I could get into something like that, maybe that would be great. But I have to see what happens. I'll probably end up being a brickie's labourer again. After all this.
Well, it'll be very interesting because we'll be joined by the rest of the housemates later. But for now, will you please say thank you and Jota to Ben. Thanks, mate. No problem. We are now going to cross live into the Big Brother house. Now, you take us through this, Ben.
Yep.
Pete and Corinne are there. Remember, everyone, quiet as a mouse. Can you hear us, guys?
Rovi, how are you doing, mate?
Very good. Petty Rock?
Oh, I'm fantastic, mate. Now, this is obviously a lot of the action went on when the lights were out in the Big Brother house. We've got Blair Sheets to prove it. And, stop it, Rose Thorn. So what we're trying to do is we're going to turn the lights out. And there's all these balls on the ground. The contestants are going to come in. The celebrities are waiting with their ball bags. Yes. Yes. I never thought I'd say this, but Jeannie Little has a ball bag. Now, the lovelies come in. It's all going to be in the dark. They're going to put the balls into the ball bags, and we're going to count whoever gets the most. Whoever gets the least gets evicted, and that's it. There's going to be more ball handling here than Big Brother Uncut. It's going to be big. So let's get going. Let's get the lights out, and let's
okay.
Go. Let's go, Corinne.
Yes, remember okay. We have our teams, our live listers,
one,
and our celebrities.
1, 2, 3, go! Lights out!
What's going on here, but this is pitch black for them. Now, just so you know, Ben, we were seeing a lot of the stuff like this. You guys probably thought it was pitch black. We could see what was going on quite clearly. So, is any of this just your bedroom?
Yeah, it is.
Is there anything that we should know about that maybe you don't want them to check out?
A few things are hidden, so they might find them.
We're down to 2 seconds. 1. Time is up. I repeat, time is up. Now time to count the balls, I believe.
We're going to count up the balls in the break and we'll be back to you after that. Okay,
okay, thank you, guys. We'll be back to check on who will be the first evictee from our celebrity and live list contestants. When we return, we'll be playing True or False with Mandy Moore and Justin Torkelson from Bold and the Beautiful on Rove Live. To that one, if I'm going to this one, you're drunk. Welcome back to Rove Live, special 2-hour edition. Wow, it's exciting. Are you thrilled? How could you not be? Now, of course, we have our live listers and celebrities in the Big Brother house. We're about to make the first eviction. So let's cross to Pete and Corinne to see who's gone. Okay, now, who are the teams? Let's introduce ourselves to the teams first, guys. We haven't quite done that yet before we say goodbye to someone.
Okay, we have Krista and Joey here. We met Joey on the phone last week.
Yep.
Doing very well.
Hello. We've got Amanda and Peter here. We've got Jerry and Jeannie here. I like the J's. And Grant and Camille over there.
Beautiful work. Great to have you all on board. Thank you very much. Now, let's make the first eviction. Our game in the dark. How did we go?
It's getting tense, Rove. The balls have been counted and I'll open my invisible envelope. It's time to go. Peter and Amanda.
Oh. Okay, this is... Peter, how do you feel? How do you feel, the first evictee? How does it feel?
How'd you go?
Okay, wait, this is the bit I get to do. Hang on a second. I've been waiting all night to do this bit. Wait. Are you ready? On me, Ponzi, on me.
This is Big Brother. You have 20 seconds to leave the house. Not 20
celebrities are out of the house. We're going to be whittling it down to one celebrity and one live lister. We'll be back with more of Pete and Corinne in the Big Brother house later. Now, of course, remember that the Big Brother auction is happening. Items from the house are up for bid on the Big Brother website, www.bigbrother.com.au. There it is. Makes my eyes go crazy. See?
And watching you.
I auditioned for the voice of Big Brother, and for some reason, they didn't think that was a good idea. I really reckon that could have taken off. Time to play some true or false with our two celebrity guests for this evening. One is the star of Bold and the Beautiful, the most watched television show in the world. Yes, don't believe those Baywatch rumours, my friends. He plays the part of Rick Forrester. The other is our musical guest we'll be seeing a little later on. Her name is Mandy Moore. Her self-titled album is Mandy Moore. Will you please welcome them now, Justin Torkelson and Mandy Moore. I'll start with you, Mandy. How are things going with you at the moment?
Things are very, very well. Thank you very much.
Are you enjoying your stay here in our fair country?
I am. I wish I could be here for a little bit longer, but it's all good. At least I'm here.
One of them brief promotional tour things?
Brief promotional tours, no time off, no time to actually see the site, so...
How excited are you about singing later on tonight?
I'm very excited.
Blow the roof off the dump, really, honestly.
I will, just for you.
Just go to town. And Justin, how are things going with you? Bold and the Beautiful, big star, the kids love you.
Yeah, it's things are going wonderful. It's been a crazy couple of months, and I'm here in Australia for about 9 days. And I've been here for 8 hours, and I'm kind of tired and jet-lagged, but it's been a fun day.
Have you been checking out the whole Big Brother thing that's happening here? Because it didn't take off in the States. I didn't really dig it all that
much. Totally different in America.
Yeah. I think because we had so many reality shows that Big Brother was just one with Survivor and Temptation Island.
There was
a flood and people were kind of like, what's going on?
Chaining people together for like 12 hours.
Do you know what it was? People weren't smacking their bums enough. That's what it was.
Yeah, there was no bum smacking.
Very disappointing. There you go. Okay, well, let's get into true or false. Of course, the guys will be asked questions about each other. They must answer true or false. We're playing for live listers at home. Mandy?
Okay, Claire Hopkinson from Mackay, Queensland.
Lovely. And Justin?
I'm playing for Shelley Murphy Adelaide from South Australia.
He certainly is. Let's get...
What it says?
It's from Adelaide in South Australia. Oh, okay. Let's get into the first one.
Hey, nobody told me.
That's okay.
What can I do?
He's new to the country.
I'm a stupid American.
He doesn't have to be here, you know. Number one show in the world. I'm sorry, Justin, I really apologize.
Adelaide, South Australia.
Just do that when I'm back. There you go. Kids love the bum dance. Okay, first question to Justin, answer true or false. Mandy's family was once sent a photograph of their house in Orlando that had been taken from space.
I'm gonna have to go with true.
Mandy?
True. Very true.
Correct, 1 point.
Well, that happened.
Somebody, they said it was quicker to find the picture of my house, like, from a satellite than it was to actually print it out. So that kind of freaked me out. No, it's not. I mean, it's like a regular-sized house in a suburban neighborhood.
So you don't live in the Great Wall of China or anything like that?
No, not at all.
It's another wonder of the world.
It was very, very weird, yeah.
Do you have it framed or anything like that?
No. I think we ended up throwing it away. Yeah. We were quite frightened by it.
Crushed a few fans' hearts there.
Sorry.
That's okay. Mandy, next question is to you. Justin was elected to the Emmy Hall of Fame for his work on The Bold and the Beautiful. True or false?
I'm going to have to go with true.
Justin?
Yeah.
True? Correct, 1 point. And that was for Outstanding Younger Actor of the Year, is that correct?
Yeah, a month ago on Friday.
Did you check that out as well?
Yeah.
We're just going, whatever we get, we'll check it out.
Yeah, I was like, this is kind of cool, whatever.
Emmys are pretty good. Hey, Sideshow Bob got one as well. Let's not forget that. Next question is to Justin. Mandy is teaming up with Brandy and ex-Wham member Andrew Ridgely to release an album entitled Mandy, Brandy and Andy.
I'd like to buy a vowel. No? Oh, wait, yeah, I'm going to have to go with false.
Mandy?
False.
Yes, we just put that in there for our own amusement.
That'd be pretty cool.
Random.
Okay, Mandy, In the episode of The Bold and the Beautiful that aired in the States on CBS on June 13 of this year, Justin's character Rick was heard to say, No, you don't know the meaning of relaxed until you've had a massage from Kurt. You know, he's just gonna turn you into a big, wet noodle. True or false?
Well, it kind of scares me that you know that. So, you know what? I'm gonna have to go with false.
No, I said that. Hey, you know, they told me to say it.
You so have to explain this.
Okay, please. All right. So, no, it's a scene, and Rick and Amber, and, you know, I just, we, you know, because the Foresters, they're millionaires. They have more money than they know what to do with, and so we have, like, a masseuse come every week, and so I got off, and I said, Amber, you don't know, relax until you get on that table, and Kurt gives you a massage, and you feel like a big wet noodle. And then she said no, and I said yes, and then she got on the table and started having dreams about Deacon.
How many times have we heard that story?
Yes.
Okay, final question. Let's just get a score check. The score is Justin 2, Mandy 1. It is now time for a question to Justin. You could walk away with this. If you get it wrong, I will take a point off. Let's make it spicy. Justin, Mandy will soon appear, or is appearing, in Australian cinemas as a female bear cub.
False.
Mandy?
True.
Denied!
And we finished with a tie.
Yes? What's the movie?
Dr. Dolittle 2, which was really funny. I'm in Gary Marshall's new film, The Princess Diaries. I just did the press junket a couple weeks ago, and I had no idea that I was actually in the movie. Like, none. And people were asking me about it and stuff like that. They're like, no, we've seen the movie, we saw your name in the credits. But I'd gone in, like, a couple months ago before the movie was even finished and actually did the voice for this little character, like, small part at the end of the film. And I was supposed to go back in to redo the part in case the movie changed, but I guess it didn't, and they just kept me in there, and wow, I had no idea.
Really? So
no
they pulled
clue.
The Swiftie on you? This went, oh, do did. This... audition. Was it just some guy with like a really elaborate flower going, just say these lines into this?
No, I mean it was technical and everything. I went into the studio and did this part, but I thought that they were going to recast it and somebody else was going to end up doing it, but there I was. I guess I made
too
it
good.
Technically.
You're too good. You're one take wonder. Let's not tonight. Now this is the last question. I must make this even. I just realised that I have one more to ask you, Mandy. So let's make it fair.
Okay.
This is for you. The score at the moment. Let me just check. It's Justin still. Well, someone just got a score then, didn't they? No. Well, no. He must take a point off. Didn't I say I was going to take a point off?
What?
Take a point off. So now it's one all. Oh. Mandy can walk away. Mandy can walk away with the victory. If you can answer this question correctly, Justin dressed up as a squirrel, the school mascot, when he was at Boulder High in his youth.
You know what? Walking in, you mentioned something about Colorado, that it felt like Colorado outside, so I'm gonna... Wait, looking in your eyes. Okay, now, do you feel the pressure, the tension in the room?
Yeah, exactly. Come on.
I'm gonna have to go with true.
Justin.
I did go to Boulder High, but our mascot was a panther.
So it is false.
Oh.
A panther. The correct answer is a panther, which means it's a tie. Justin, I'm one. Mandy, I'm one.
Yes.
Thanks.
But I do have a special little gift for you, Mandy, before you leave. Just as a special thank you. Your album sales here in Australia have gone so well. It is with great pleasure that we present to you this massive record! To commemorate album sales in Australia.
Thank you.
That
very
is how
much.
Incredibly popular you are. Is it hurting your knees?
It's not at all. Wow, this is such a surprise. Thank you so much.
Good luck putting that on the plane for the way home.
Well, I know, right?
We're pleased to thank Justin Torkelton and Mandy Moore, who will be back later in the show. And when we return, all the kids from Big Brother here on Roadline. Welcome back to Rove Live. Hey, who wants to play What the? I know you don't play it, we just kind of present it, but I feel it's something we can all enjoy. To help us with the presentation of tonight's What The, being a very special two-hour episode, we thought we'd just give it that little bit of something else. So we have a very special guest to help us with the presentation. Of course, being our big special with all the Big Brother cast, we thought it would not be complete without Big Brother himself. Unfortunately, he wasn't available, so instead, we've got Big Kev! I know what he's going to say, but how you doing, Big Kev?
I'm excited!
Now, Kev, I'll just take you through how What The works. I will show the humorous item, or the What The, after I've read out the names in a humorous fashion. And then when the audience laughs, which means they got it, that's when you say, What The? OK, so we'll have a little practice, OK? I've just held up something funny. We've all laughed.
What The?
Excellent. I'm feeling good.
I'm feeling good.
I'm excited, Big Kev. I'm excited. All this could fall apart. We'll see how it goes. Okay, the first one. This was given to me at a 21st party over the weekend. I'm stoked about this one. It's from Alicia Galvin. Alicia Galvin from Woi Woi in New South Wales. Now, it is a burgering, not just any burgering. What do you think is the biggest burgering you've ever seen in your life, my friends? Probably what? That big? How about this? What the?
I am not an animal. I am a piece of snack food.
Big Kev?
What the?
That doesn't look like a burger ring. It looks like a burger penis, doesn't it? That's probably more exciting. There we go. Okay, the next one is actually from John and Corinne, our very own John Tabar and Corinne Grant. They recently went on a trip to the States, and while there, they spotted this photo for a plumbing service called Mr. Router.
What the?
What I love about Mr. Router is his catchphrase is quick as a wink. Somehow I think that's a typo. Because I get the feeling that Mr. Router It's a creeper. It's a creeper. Somehow I think Mr. Reader would turn up to your house with, like, a, you know, the plumbing stuff, a wrench, and just some pool cleaning equipment. Do you call for a plumber? The next one is from Jennifer Waldorf in Minyama, Queensland. It is some obstetric cream, which has the warning on it, keep out of eyes and avoid contact with the brain.
What the?
It's such a yearning, what the? Somehow I think whoever wrote that avoided contact with his brain when he wrote it. But what I love is the fact they have to write that, like someone's going to be putting it on just going, oh, now stab me brain. The next one is a photo from Melissa McKenzie from Merrowa in Western Australia. It is a photo taken from a petting zoo. It is a simple photo of a cow with the label chicken.
What the?
I get the feeling Big Kev was out with the Big Brother kids last night. Yes, actually, that's probably the first time you've actually got beef that tastes like chicken as well, so that's funny. But the weird thing is, you think that cow looks weird, you should see when it lays eggs. It's frightening stuff. The final one is a toy from Anna Clark in Maryborough, Queensland. It pretty much speaks for itself when you pull the string on the back. We got a close-up of this one. Thank you very much. Thank you, Big Kev. Buy the man's products. They're bloody good. Can I tell you, Big Kev, I used your goo remover. You know your goo remover?
Yeah.
I went to the Kylie Minogue concert and I had my program on the floor, and when I picked it up, it had chewing gum stuck to it. I was very forlorn. All the photos of me after the concert are like this. Used the Big Kev goo remover, crisis over.
What can I say? I'm excited!
Buy the man's stuff, keep it in Australia. That's why he wears that shirt. It's not just for show. Please thank Big Kev, everybody. If you author, join in the fun and send it to this address. What the? P.O. Box 212, Richford, Victoria 3121.
If broken, books are true.
Well, if you were cooped up with Barbie all day, you'd probably do that too. Time to cross back to the Big Brother house, where Pete and Corinne are there with our live listers and celebrities for another game to eliminate another person from the house. What have we got this time?
Hello! Okay, we've got a kick a chook competition this time in memory of what Pete did to the chook that was in the house. Now, I just want to let you know, no chickens were really harmed in the making of this challenge, but some soccer balls were. Now, the idea is that we get, there's three soccer balls behind each celebrity. They kick them like so. God, I hope I do this all right. Oh, they don't kick it like that. They kick it much better than that to their competitor down the other end, who then picks it up and puts it in a pen. They've got three balls each. Last one to get them in is out. Jeannie, how are you feeling?
Right, fantastic. I'm ready for them. First, you had two right hands, or left.
I think Jeannie might have had Grant Kenny's nutri-grain this morning. Okay, guys, are you ready to go?
Yep.
Right, yeah, okay, just Grant, I just want to know if Grant has a game plan, Corinne, before this. He's looking pretty psyched. He's a sporting guy.
Mate, I've been getting beat up by these two women here, but I am kind of used to that.
He's a wounded man. It could affect it. Let's start it off. Away we go, Corinne.
All
right,
on the count of three. You ready?
Yep.
One, two, three, go!
Yeah. Oh, sorry, Dad.
Camille's away. Camille's away. Camille's got the first one. Jerry's got the second one.
That was a bit off.
Punting out chooks. Jerry actually needed that time. We have our live listers now dumping the chooks in their nets.
Behind.
Coming to you live from the Big Brother house.
Come on, Camille.
We have our winners. Do we have our second places?
Chris and Mandy, you're out of here. Get up.
We have an eviction. I repeat, we have an eviction.
This is Tiny Brother with me here.
Get out of the house.
Excellent.
And then there were four. There we go. Down there at the house, we'll be having more frivolity from the Big Brother house when we return soon on Rove Live. Coming up next, the kids from Big Brother and Rachel Griffiths. Welcome back to Rove Live. Now, of course, we've got all the kids from Big Brother coming up very soon. I talked about it earlier in the show. A lot of people are feeling a few withdrawal symptoms. I didn't even know why I bothered attempting to put my foot up then. I just dragged it down anyway. I just went, get comfy. No, get serious. Because people are hurting. We all, a lot of us out there are sort of feeling a bit, because Big Brother's finished. I say, because I can't think of a word. You know, you do that sometimes. Just go, I can't, you know, I'm feeling sort of, but a little bit, at the same time. So a lot of people are probably feeling, you know, a bit down. I myself am one of those people. I'm still calling the eviction line, even though there's no one there. I do it, I just call up and go, what about the couch? The carpet? Can you kick out the carpet? It's very sad. I've even had to get down to the point where I'm to wean myself off the Big Brother experience, I've had to get patches. Yeah. It really is that sad. And I notice everyone's getting the barbs out now. Now that it's all finished, when it's on air, we all love it. It's the nation's number one program. But now we want to sink the boot in. And to all those cynics out there who are saying it's just some kind of marketing exercise, I say, well, wait till you get the board game. That'll change your mind. Anyway, so there are a lot of people who are hurting out there because of Big Brother withdrawal. So I thought I'd come up with a few handy hints on how to get over Big Brother withdrawal. One of the first ones, just to sort of help you get it out of your system, you can just walk around accusing people of smirking. Just anyone, just you, you're smirking at me. How bad was that accent? That was atrocious. Another one you could use, just kick chickens. That's another one I could suggest. Or if someone really, really pisses you off, just mumble 2 points. If you want to find out what it's like to be evicted, you can just stop paying your rent, is another good one. Another thing I would suggest is reading Judith Durham's Colours of My Life. Yes, it might not make you feel better, but it's a darn good read. Oh, Judith, will you ever learn? Another one you can do, this is always good fun, order a pizza and then hire two security guards to prevent the delivery boy from bringing them into the house. And the main thing you can do to help yourself get over the whole Big Brother experience, get a life.
I just like women to have some teeth.
My next guest for this evening, she's probably best known as Muriel's friend in that wedding movie. She's also gone on to attend the Academy Awards as a nominee herself. She is now one of the actors around the world who is taking the step behind the camera into directing. She joins us now. We please welcome the one and only Rachel Griffiths. Beautiful. You got a little camera like me. Can I take one of you?
Yeah, sure.
Look, I got one too.
Good. Let's do it again. Let's replay the moment. I reckon mine was sexier.
Yours is... That's great. We could breathe them. Is that for your own personal records?
Yeah.
Do you do that all the time?
Yeah, I actually might just sell that one.
Yeah.
Now, I had to get your autograph later and I'll put it on this for my cousin Tim.
Hello, Tim.
Hello, Tim.
Hello, Tim.
And I also want to tell Bianca that I got every member of Big Brother's autograph for her, which is why I'm here. So you are one lucky girl, Bianca.
Very. So have you been chatting to them?
Chatting to?
To all the Big Brother kids. Did you do the do, or did you go sign this and then leave?
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, I came here with a task. It's completed. Now there can be time for chit-chat, but before it was very much business.
Business. Did you watch the show? Do you know who they all are?
No, because I watched it in America and they're all different. And I had those... Yeah, they were different.
Yeah.
And they were, like, older. Like, in America, the guy...
We didn't have any old guys here.
No, he was, like, 55 and he was, like, ex-Navy, you know? And he was, like, he was like the George Bush. And he looks like George Bush, and he won.
So instead of wanting them to get evicted, he wanted them to go to the chair? Was that it?
Right, exactly. He just said straight to that electric.
They had a guy with one leg in the American one, didn't they?
Yeah, I think that might have been this ex-Navy guy. Maybe he was, like, ex-Gulf War or something. But I think here it must be more about, like, wanting them to shag, because they're all so young and gorgeous.
They didn't get up to much Rumpy Pumpy. A bit of the old dance and doona, called it. Yeah.
Dance and doona.
Oh, yeah, believe me. There'll be a lot
That's
of talk
gonna
about that later
be in the Oxford Dictionary
on.
Next week.
Oh, yeah. Now, is it nice to be home, though?
Oh, so nice. I love Melbourne. It's great. I came home to shoot a short, which I did last week, closed down half the streets of Melbourne, and had an absolute ball doing it. Melbourne crews are incredible. I had the most fantastic crew any director could dream of having.
Now, that's Roundabout, and you play the role of director. You also wrote this one as well.
I did, yeah.
Now, what's it like being an actress and going into behind the camera?
Well, it's great because you can look like S-H-I-T like I do now.
Do you know what you're doing there, or are you just moving your hands?
No, I do know what I'm doing, but I look like an idiot. Look, what a wanker. Sorry, can I say that?
You can say wanker, just don't say bloody hell.
I'm a whore. No, I actually mostly knew what I was doing. This was one of the scenes where we kind of closed down a major Melbourne arterial thanks to Mon John Escort Services.
Oh.
He escorts... Movie services, not the other kind.
Oh, not so escort agencies.
He's like, oh, I want to shut down the Westgate. Okay, what hours?
I thought you meant like escort service, like you just shut down and you
just
get all these
scantily clad ladies to distract everybody. He's a pretty dapper dresser. You never know.
So what's it like being a director coming from an acting background?
Well, I think it's great because you do understand what actors need, and not all directors do, you know. Some are so visual or coming from, you know, a much more head, you know, intellectual position that they don't really know how to communicate to us what we're not doing right or what they require of us. So that's one great thing. And the other thing is just, you know, how much movie experience, how much on-set experience I've had. So I just know, you know, how to anticipate certain things, and I know how long certain scenes will take. And so that's, you know, much easier than had I not done that.
Would you think the actors would mouth off a little more because they go, you're one of us, you can't tell us what to do?
No, not at all. I think they kind of love it.
They don't? Because they're mates?
No, because, like, yeah, well, one is their mates, you know, like my dear friend Kim Ginjal, you know, and there I am directing my, you know, my friend, and I just, like, I'd start directing him, and then I'd just hug him and say, it's so good to see you. He'd go, oh, right, back to the scene.
Work mode. And you also wrote it as well, which is very impressive.
Yeah.
So where'd you get the idea from? What's it about?
It's about a man that kind of has a nervous breakdown, or what used to be called a nervous breakdown, on the way to work. It's very much about undiagnosed depression. It's about a particular generation of men that are probably the least likely to tell anybody that they're having problems, that they're feeling depressed, that they're having anxiety attacks. They're more likely to say, I'm having heart palpitations, or, you know, it's a bit like the guy in The Sopranos, you know, it takes him to go to a shrink for a year before he admits that what he's experienced is actually, you know, anxiety. So I just came across this story about a man that on the way to work got stuck on a roundabout and went around and around and around and around all day. And it just really stayed with me as a beautiful metaphor. And, we've been sponsored by the National Depression Initiative, Beyond Blue, and it's a big issue in this country that needs to be talked about more.
So it's kind of like a road rage thing as well, in a sense?
Well, it's the opposite. I think most movies that are made about men snapping, when men snap, they, you know, grab a K12 and go into some shopping mall and spray everybody.
Isn't that a type of yacht?
Yeah, probably. I just so made that up. I'm so busted.
I love the K12 number.
That's like me directing, get out the 4S, stop and put it on.
I know she did this at the same time.
Yeah, right, exactly. So
it's not about someone snapping, it's about snapping
in a different way. It's not about snapping aggression, it's about a man who implodes instead of explodes, and that's a story that isn't really told very often.
Now, this is a short film.
It is a short film, but it's not a small film.
Sure, that should be the little byline to it. Now, you've also made Tulip was another one, which I have seen, and I like that one. It's a very sweet one. Is there a reason why you don't go with long films, if that is, or full-length features?
Well, you know, one, I don't have the time, because I'm an incredibly successful movie actress, and it pays... It pays good money, so, you know, I had a week off to come home and do that short. No, but, you know, the group of filmmakers I'm working with, we, you know, do things at the level that, you know, we're confident at. Chillet was very contained. It was set on a farm. It was a four-day shoot. This was a six-day shoot. Literally, we're closing down half of Melbourne at a time to do it. Saturday night, I had 130 extras. I had eight cop cars, a lockdown intersection, I had two emergency services vehicles with two crews of eight, a cherry picker, two camera units. It was just, all my friends who turned up to kind of support my little film just kind of came on.
Man, what do you want, like, Griffiths?
Yeah, I know. It was like, I like it big.
That's huge. And that's for a six-day shoot.
Yeah, six-day shoot. It was great. So, but it was, you know, I guess the next thing we do will be to tell a longer story. But I think short films are great. I think people love them. I think you can learn an enormous amount making them. And why not make... I mean, if this was a long film done, it would be like a $10 million movie. So we just had a little experience of making
it. Would bore people to tears like Pearl Harbor.
No, yeah, right.
Well, you're on first. It just went for a week, let me
tell
you.
Yeah, it did a bit.
When they took off their shirts,
it was pretty interesting. I personally found it quite profound.
Oh, no, you're joking. When they did the... We're giving our blood in the Coke bottle and then we're going to kill the Japanese.
I just did a movie with that camera crew and I couldn't bag it. We all had a cast and crew screening. We went to see it and we all had to come and go.
You sure you weren't doing? It was a stinker. It's all right. Now, just one final question.
Yeah.
Would you see yourself as a director or an actor? Like, if you were to, because you've been nominated for an Oscar, would you rather accept one as a director or as an actress?
No, I'm in a very lucky position. I don't have to, you know. I've got a great group of filmmakers here that I'm enjoying working with, and I get flown all around the world to do movies, so... I can have my cake and I can eat it too.
Opens up better chances. You're in two categories
Absolutely.
Now.
Absolutely.
It's win-win. Well, best of luck with it all, and thank you for joining us, Rachel Griffiths.
Thank you.
We'll be back with all those Big Brother kids. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back. The kids are ready. You should see, I have just... an absolute sea of bunny ears staring at me here. Sorry, I just got caught scratching my bum. Excellent. It was just a cut away so I can scratch myself. Dag-dabbit. Well, it's been 14 people, one house, 23 cameras, and millions upon millions of Australians riveted every week to a bunch of people in a house just gabbing on about stuff. We fell in love with them, and then we voted them out when we got sick of them. It's now time to welcome the entire cast of Big Brother. That's all we have time for. Will you please thank the cast? Okay. How are we all doing, group?
Great.
Yeah. Really good. Now, Ben, I'll start. Hungover? No, be honest, Pete. Are you hungover? Okay.
It's always hungover.
Who was into stumps last night? Shana.
Always.
No, you were. Who was last standing?
These two.
Yeah.
Okay, boys. Let's get down to it. What was this greyhound race thing?
Actually, we didn't use this one, but it's a gift. I promise you, we didn't use it. It's for you.
Thank you very much. That could be auctioned off at the end of the night.
Especially if you ever want to try
his out. Oh, yeah. No cameras. Definitely no cameras. So how big was last night for all of you?
Awesome. Huge.
Huge.
Yeah?
Big time.
Well, let me start with you, Rach. Let's see how we're going here. Because now you were in the house for 3 days. Probably the least, the least out of everybody.
Let's not play it down. I was in there for 3.5.
3.5? Forgive me. Now, obviously, everyone's very close. There's a nice group happening here. Is it weird for you? Do you feel somewhat on the outer because you didn't really get to bond with everyone?
I feel a bit like a loser, but, you know. No, everyone, I guess... even though I wasn't in there with some of the people, there's almost a common bond even if you haven't lived with them because they've seen you on telly, and then if you haven't lived with them, you've seen them, so you feel like you already know them. And it didn't take any time. I met these guys at a photo shoot, most of the ones that I hadn't lived with, and it's just been like that from there.
Now, how was it for the rest of you when they said, oh, we've got some intruders coming in? I know, Blair, you were pretty upset by that. How was it when they said, oh, we've got two new people coming into the house? Oh, wait. I just realised we haven't heard Blair talk yet. I did mention before about Blair's voice. Now, no one else, this question is directed to Blair. How was it, Blair, when they announced that two new people were coming into the house?
It was good.
Fairly clear who was there till stumps. So how was it, okay, for the rest of the cast when they said, oh, we've got two new people coming in, honestly, how did it feel?
I was chuffed.
Yeah?
Yeah, because I was really craving some outside stimulation from, you know, and to hear that these two were coming in, I was just like, yes, something new to talk about, because we were getting to the point where we were just constantly repeating our conversations and we were getting rather boring, actually.
Thanks.
As the ratings showed. But yeah, when these guys came in, I was rapt.
Okay, well, Anita, being one of the people who came in from the outside, you saw how it was all working, you knew everybody, you knew how we all felt, what we perceived them all as. How hard was it not to just let it all out and tell them what was going on?
It was really, really, really hard. Basically, the first 3 days I spent in the diary room being reprimanded. But it was really hard because we perceive things from the outside world, and then you come in and you can actually see them and touch them and speak with them, and they are people. So it was a really, really weird experience.
Now, how was it, okay, Ben, I'll direct this one to you, being one of the people who was very stable in the house, you and Johnny were probably the two, I felt, who were, not stable's the wrong word, I'm not offending anyone, but you were the two who are probably, I don't know, a lot of people turn to you for help and advice and that sort of thing. Being people who had been in there for weeks on end, when Anita came in and started crying when she was in there for a couple of days, did you sort of sit there going, hello?
I didn't like crying in the diary
room almost. You kept it all for the people at home.
Not for you guys.
So did you guys know that she was a bit upset by the whole experience?
Yeah, you can tell she was a bit overwhelmed by it all. It was, yeah, it would have been very hard coming in halfway through.
And was there real sympathy, or were you just thinking, we have had so much more than you can even dream of?
It was a bit of both at the time. You'd think, you know, I don't know why you are crying, but I can understand it, if it makes sense.
And did you feel that was coming from the group, Anita?
The group were really, really good to me. I think they were really... really good.
I think Blair reckons you're full of shit, Ben. Say, oh yeah, Mr. I can't speak. Okay, well, just thumbs up, thumbs down, Blair. How do you feel about Anita now? He's smirking, Anita. He's smirking. Thumbs up?
Yeah.
Did you sort everything else out? Have you sorted it all out between the two of you?
Yes.
What was it that grated?
David, it wasn't Blair. It wasn't, you
know... Oh, it was
all of us. No! I know you've been dying to ask me this stuff, I know. It was just, I had issues of my own and that I couldn't share with them. It was impossible for me to share with them, so unfortunately, I took it out on them.
Plus, you quit smoking.
Yeah.
Oh, see, that'll do it every time.
That was,
it gets ugly.
I quit smoking, though.
So did you quit smoking going in?
Yeah. I've been smoking for 8 years and I quit.
And you quit to get
so
in?
So did Peter.
Yes.
Well, we did it together. That was the other thing.
Toddy's taken up smoking since getting out, though.
He's been smoking all week.
Was it easier? Did you feel you didn't get to do anything? Like Sarah Marie, you're one of those people who made the most of a bad situation in the herb garden and things like that. How hard was it just to amuse yourselves?
Well, look what I've done. Crazy stuff. I don't know. I just caught myself singing songs and things that was probably weird.
She was good like that, though. She kind of kept us entertained as well. As annoying as she was.
Yeah, that's the thing. So, that's the thing. I don't know.
Well, I'll ask this for Christina and Sarah Marie. You were the two who were probably most nominated for eviction. In fact, you were. How did that make you feel being inside? Of course, we, as the outside world, were not voting you out, so you were stuck in there, but week after week you would come up. How did it make you feel about the rest of the people in the house?
You go.
Well, I guess I was more concerned about what I was doing wrong or why I wasn't getting along with people, so it wasn't more about how I felt about them, it was more about what can I do to make them like me more in a way and just relax and go with the situation. But it took me a long time to do that because every week I believed I was leaving. So that made it a little bit stressful.
And I think I knew my problem, but I wasn't going to tell you. I stopped doing the other thing when Ben told me off and gave me at night time I had 10:30, I had to stop making noises.
So how hard was it for all of you to deal with each other's idiosyncrasies? I guess Andy was probably one of the being the first evictee. Do you think it was because the fact that you went too hard too early? Maybe I'm thinking of Donkey Boy. So.
I think it was. I don't know, maybe I just got voted off because I was a bit too shocking or whatever, but at the last 3 days I was getting really bored too, so I was like, maybe I should just leave, you know. I don't know if people from the internet heard that and said, okay, let's vote her off, the poor thing is getting bored, whatever.
Now, Sarah Marie, or you and Donkey Boy, the two of you got into the fun with Andy at the start.
Yeah, we got into the festivities. Andy's got, you know, fewer boundaries and is easy to sort of party with, so, you know, she was always, you know, up for fun and games, as you can probably well know. And Sarah Marie, of course, I hated to start with, and then loved her after about week three, and just realised she was like, you know, the greatest sort of asset to the house, and just went, yeah, cut loose and annoy everyone, and I love it. You know, so it was good.
See, that's
beautiful. How can anyone not like Sarah Marie?
Well, tell you what, when we return, we'll talk about everyone's favourite bunny-eared girl. We'll find out the real story about all this eviction nonsense and hoo-ha that is going on when we return here on Rove Live with a big brother Kids! What are you going to do? Now, I want to get straight into you, Sarah Marie, because the...
Okay. So
it's the uncut version all over again. Well, you handed me this CD that some band has written about you.
No, they've named a band, they've called their band Hercules, and I got it from Channel 10 Studio Tonight, and it says, Sarah Marie, we love you. Like, they sing this song about me. And so they left their number on the CD, so I rang it while I said, listen to this, I've got... And they said, sure, and they keep hanging up on me, so I just want to prove to them that it was me ringing you.
Some freaker, this is getting
and
weird.
And then Gordon and Todd go, listen here, it's Todd, listen here, it's Gordon. And they're going, sure, and keep hanging up. And, going, and I was crying, I'm crying. And I started going, and doing all this stuff.
Nothing.
No.
You hear the sound of a slapping bum?
No.
Now, did you have any idea, while you were in the house, how incredibly popular you were?
No, I thought it was the same as the No.
The fact that you weren't being evicted every week, did that maybe have you thinking something was going your way?
No. I got more shy now.
We don't
now
buy
she
it.
Shuts up.
No idea at all? And what's it like being out now when you see all these people wearing the rabbit ears, doing the bum dance?
I can't believe it. I'm still in shock. I'm a little nervous still. I can't believe that, like, people, like, the little boy on the plane tonight is just talking to me, Sarah Marie, you know this, Sarah Marie, that, just chatting away, and I'm like going, whoa, how do you know all this? It's really
weird. But you've got to remember, she's actually only been out of the house one full day.
That's true.
Well, actually, hasn't done anything.
She hasn't been in the real world. This is as close as she's been.
Oh, the world probably isn't real for you anymore. Now, Lisa, I want to ask you something. You're one of the people who has come out of the house and looks like you're trying to get into the media, get into television.
Yeah.
Was that one of your intentions when you went into the house in the
Not
first
at all.
Place?
No. I was actually going to go overseas and get into events management. But I figure this is a unique opportunity. Why not make the most of it? So.
And has anything come best. Up?
Well, I'm doing something for Channel V, Snowbiz, so that'll be fun. Just two little things.
Has anyone else got any kind of TV gigs or endorsements or anything like that out of this?
Yeah, I've got it all pretty lined up. I've got a couple of games contracts with THQ. We're launching some of their new ranges. So I get
that's
to
pretty cool.
Play with all their up-and-coming titles, so that's all pretty wicked. And I think, obviously, Jim is the...
Cosmetics queen. Hey, sister.
Bend it.
Yeah. I have no idea what they are.
I'm doing it.
It's lingerie, darling.
Lingerie. Ooh. I will learn very quickly, don't worry. Are you going to be getting a modelling career, Sarah Marie? Is that right?
I don't know what I'm doing. I'm just doing what Big Brother tells me to.
I think that stopped. You're free now.
Now, Christina, when you were on the show last week, you and Pete were going on a bit of a date. How did it go?
Hasn't happened yet.
What's the go?
Big Brother won't let me go out with her at the moment. We haven't got time at the moment.
It's actually that we don't have any time.
Tell it to the judge.
Oh, we're definitely going out, though.
Yeah?
On a date.
Yeah?
Definitely.
Are we back together? Are things going okay?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, everyone's excited. I asked Christina this last week. I'll ask you the same thing. Do you see each other's boyfriend, girlfriend?
Yep. Pretty much. Yeah.
That's ironclad. Good effort.
National television?
No, I will. YouTube, you and Johnny will probably have another.
You've done that once already.
Well, that leads me to the next question. Gordon and Anita, what's going on?
There's been some, strangely circulated rumours, but...
There's no rumours. I've seen photos. You're turning up to places, you're hugging, you're cuddling.
Yeah, I hug everyone. Gemma knows that.
So, Anita, you're not knocking him back?
He's just my friend.
If he asked you out on a date, would you say yes?
Yeah.
Ask her out on a date.
Yeah, no, we hang out all the time, actually. When I'm in Sydney, we hang out quite a bit, so it's cool.
Okay.
This has turned into perfect match.
Yeah.
Let's see. Who else is interested?
I'm man out.
Oh, going to get to keep in touch.
Yeah, we always do. Definitely. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
How hard is it going to be with the interstate thing happening? Well, Shana, maybe you could organise some flights for people.
Hook it up.
Now, are you back at work?
Yes.
Is that weird when everyone else has endorsements and TV deals and stuff like that? Is there any animosity?
Stuff going on, but I'm just working as well.
How is it when people see you on the flights nowadays?
Oh, they're cool. It's really good. Yeah, there's no problems at all. I just do my job. I go there and people just, you know...
Have you had a chance to write a slide yet?
No.
It's a long time from Big Brother and to get open that bloody slide, but don't you? Now, Gretel, I want to ask you a question now while everyone's here. Yeah. What happened with the voting system on Sunday night?
Oh, yes. I thought you were going to ask me what happened. There were two other incidents that I know the House was really concerned about when I had to stand out there and say, it's time to leave. And there were two incidents when I was standing out there.
One was Gordon, was that correct?
One was Lise. I think the other was Todd. I'm not sure. And I had to stand out there, live television, open up the envelope, and it says, it's time to leave, and there's no name written on it. And it happened twice.
So what happened?
That's why I was standing there going, oh, this is interesting. Oh, shall I just guess?
Who do I want out?
Todd has not been nice to me.
So what did you do?
Guess.
Well, I guessed on one. No, I didn't. I had a... And I brought you here tonight to tell you that the winner is Andy. No, I had a little man in my ear, but of course I didn't realise what was going on, so I waited and just said, oh, this is interesting. Oh, hello, someone told me.
I guess you're not going to say there's nothing on the card on air.
No. I wasn't going to do that because, you know, we're a slick professional group, despite the lack of evidence. What happened on Sunday night was that we were prepared. I don't even know. We need a phone call from Big Brother to tell me if I can say this. But it really looked... Oh, well, if I'm fired, I don't have a job anyway. Ben was about to be evicted. And this is on Sunday night. And we had prepared, thinking, I got this message, all right, it looks like Ben. They were just about to close the phone lines. There were about 8 or 9 minutes to go. Ben was in the lead. And in that 8 or 9 minutes, Sarah Marie's votes went up. And we don't know why. And that's why we had Morderton. And, I know Sarah Marie's grandma was trying to vote her out of the house.
At the beginning.
She was embarrassed about the bum dance.
No, my nonna voted me out when she saw me kiss Andy.
So nonna's there on the phone. But anyway,
but then she won the bum dance at the shopping centre and she's 80 years old. So then she likes me.
Yeah. Anyway, so that's what happened. And where I was there, all right, it looks like it's Ben, it looks like it's Ben. And I'm thinking, okay, well, we've got to go to this tape package and this and this and this and this. And then that's it. Oh, no, it looks like Sarah Marie will have to stay tuned. And we all had to stay tuned, waiting, not knowing what sort of show it was going to be and what was happening. And then they audited the whole thing. And it literally turned around, say, 7 or 8 minutes. It just went bang.
So do we have an official tally of how many votes Sarah Marie lost by on the night?
I don't know what it is, but yes, it would. I mean, of course.
I mean, a lot, or was it? I mean, I've heard conflicting reports from 24 to 200.
Well, the one that I was told, and I'm pretty bad on facts and figures today, but I thought, and please don't bet on this, but that it was about 1,200 votes. Now, when you factor in, and this I might be making this up too, but it was about 500,000 people voting.
Wow.
It's a pretty tiny margin. So the bloke who was going to be evicted on Sunday night won the whole thing.
Well, how does that make you feel, Ben? These are frightfully uncomfortable. So how does that make you feel, knowing that you were a hair's breadth away from...
Well, that's when I get out of my family, said you were coming out. You were beating Sam. You were going to be the one to come out. And then something just happened and people started voting for Sarah Marie.
Your mum did have a mobile on the set.
Yeah. Well, let me ask now. There's rumours, of course, Series 2. I think it's inevitable that one will happen. Do any of you have any advice for anyone who is willing to take it up?
Keep laughing.
Don't do it?
Go for it. It's the best experience of your life. It's great.
Just I'm going yourself. Back.
Would you be allowed to have another crack at it?
Just like quite a real go of it? Somebody gets stuck.
So no?
Oh, I'd do it again. But I think that this time I probably had the best deal out of anybody. It was just 5 minutes really in there, and it was hilarious at the time, but I didn't have to take it seriously, which is good. I think I
did anyone done. Not enjoy it?
I want to say.
Honestly? The whole country watching your private stuff each and every day? Maybe a little bit?
That's not to say it wasn't great getting out though, as well. I mean, we all had fun in there, but it was such a relief to get out of the
When you get out, imagine. You look back and it's just, that night when you come out, it's like the best night of your life.
Well, okay, from a housemate's point of view, for Series 2, would you have any advice for the big brothers, for the producers, on how they could make it better for you guys in there?
I actually think that the nominees of that particular week need to be prepared a little bit more for the onslaught that's about to happen, because you've gone in there for doing absolutely nothing, bored out of you, like actually coping with being so bored, to all of a sudden not having a second to yourself, and all of these things that you're fantasizing about and dreaming about that you really want to do while you're in the house, you don't have a chance to do them when you're out. I haven't had more than a 10-minute phone conversation with my mum. You know, I was even over in Perth the other day and I spent all of a couple of hours with her, and that was in between trying to do everything else with everybody else around me. And I think that's a real shock, and maybe a little bit more sort of preparation for that would be good.
Yeah. Yeah, but don't forget that if there is a second series, the whole country has watched this series, yeah. So they will be prepared.
And I think everyone signing up for it now will go, ooh, I can become famous. Now, last question, just a show of hands for this one. Who thinks their fame will last? In all honesty, who thinks, say, give it 6 months, a year, and you'll still be around?
I think it depends on what you're doing. It does. It depends on what you do. Like when we spoke last time, I was saying I think everybody wants to get different things out of it, and I think if you're careful about what you choose to do and think about your movements and think about what you do, it can make the difference between it being a flash in the pan or having longevity. I think you've just got to, you know, choose the right things and do the right things, and then possibly it may go on.
Well, best of luck to all of you, and take it easy tonight, or just, hey, drink yourselves into oblivion. Thanks for joining us, the Big Brother Kids, and congratulations once again to Ben, the man, the myth. We'll return and cross to the Big Brother house for the last time ever, and Mandy Moore as well. To the final bit of our two-hour expedition, that is Rove Live for this week. It's time to cross for the last time on television, for the time being anyway, to the Big Brother house. All the kids are here, but we've chucked a bunch of live listers and some would-be celebrities in the house. It's now time to cross to Peter Hellyer and Corinne Grant to wrap this nugget up. How are you doing out there, kids?
Fantastic, Rove. It's the final eviction. We're all very excited, and it's like Big Brother meets It's a Knockout for this last one. We're very excited about that. This is what's going to happen. We've got the celebrities, Grant Kenning and Jenny Little. Has there ever been more of a mismatch? I don't think so. They're at a fence. I think it's a fence. I'm not sure because Lisa's not sitting on it. But anyway, they're going to run in to the herb garden, grab the fake plastic breast, it's classy. Run through to Herb Garden, careful not to fall over, not roll an ankle. Into the big doona. They go to the big doona, there's two lumps there. That's Ebony, two Ebonies. They grab Ebony. Ebony was, of course, in the house for 3.5 days, which is 3.5 days more than Rachel. Then they run out. They throw Ebony into the kennel. And then they run into the house, and Corinne will take it from there.
All right, and then the celebrities come in, they take their fake boobs off, they put them on their live listers, the live listers go into the bathroom, there's a whole heap of wet jocks in there in tribute to the way Pete used to shower and wash his clothes. They whack a pair of them on, they run over to the kitchen, there's a big tub of flour each, there's a donkey at the bottom of it. I think we all know what that's in reference to. They grab the donkey, they run over to the stairs, they put an exercise ball between their legs without using their hands, they run up over the stairs, they give the donkey to Pete and I, they drop the exercise ball, they fly into the pool, they swim to the other end of the pool, there's a pair of goggles there with Big Brother eyes on them, they grab that, they get out of the pool, they put them on, first one to us wins. Whew.
Sorry, I missed all that. What was it? I'm sure we'll pick it up as we go along. Be sure not to hit your head like Johnny. Do not hit your head like Johnny. Okay, well, on the count of three, start them off, Petty Rock.
One, two, three, go! Get out of here!
Away they go. They're going through the herb garden. They have grabbed their breasts. I repeat, they have grabbed their breasts. Under the doonas now, the dancing doonas, looking for their little ebonies. I can't see who's winning. It's first out is Grant Kenny, looking very classy. He has his ebony. She's in the kennel. Oh, Jeannie's lagging behind. She needs more niacin and iron.
Where's Jeannie?
Grant's lifeless is already in the shower. Jeannie's bringing the free air. Pick up the pace, pick up the pace. Looking for the donkeys in the flower now. They have the donkey. And the breasts are looking a bit skewed, actually.
Oh, it's classy.
Oh, yeah. Very highbrow, very highbrow.
It's a good look, Roby. Give me the donkey. The donkey and your radio pack. Can't get that wet.
How cold is this water going to be? Big Brother people are telling me this pool is cold.
Come on, Jerry!
Come on!
Did you guys know that camera was there?
Come on! Oh, the trees are going up!
Come on!
Entering the home straight now. PlayStation 2, they got the Big Brother Uncut video, the board game, the CD. Congratulations to all our live listeners, thanks to all our celebs. That is the Big Brother house. Bid farewell, it could be a while. Unless you're going to see it yourself at the end of this month at Dream World. Now, before we go, something I must point out, the Big Brother online auction has finished. All the gear in your house went for over $20,000 to the kids at Canteen. Thank you very much. The bid's closed for them in another 2 weeks. They're currently valued over $3,000.
My God.
There you go. 2 days before the bidding closes on that. How about one little bum dance before we finish, just to sort of come on. I know you're frightened. The kids like it. You've created a monster.
I'm going to try. Joe, oh, my God.
There you go. Close the show. Thanks very much to all the Big Brother kids for taking part, as well as all our other guests for this evening. Next week on the show, Senator Natasha Stott Despoja, and from Saturday Night Live and Juice Bigelow, male gigolo Rob Schneider. To take us out tonight will be Mandy Moore. This is a self-titled album, Mandy Moore. It is in the top 20, and tonight she is playing the single that won her that huge record in my pocket. It's Mandy Moore. I'm Rofe McManus. Thanks for watching. Say hi to your mum for me. See ya!
Try to find me in the spaces, drawn to my song. Oh, only need to keep from sinking. Close your eyes as if you're thinking. Prayed all along, then my eyes are revealed. Don't you not